Flash flood emergency. How common are these once-in-a-lifetime rains becoming? How can we stop kids from drowning here? And how do we handle another ghost candidate? Welcome to the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. I'm your host, Tim Padgett. In the next hour, we'll help you dry out with a deeper look at what just hit us. Biblical rain, 20 inches of it over a matter of just hours. Experts call it a 1 in 1,000 years event, but didn't we just have one of those last year? Also, after another child drowns in a South Florida pool this month, we'll discuss efforts to ramp up swimming instruction here, especially for minority children. And ahead of our August primary election, we'll examine the epidemic of bogus candidates. All that coming up right after the news. I'm Tim Padgett. Welcome to the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. Bienvenidos, bienveni, benvindo. This week, Florida Governor Ron DeSantis declared a state of emergency for South Florida after torrential rain, more than a foot of it in a matter of hours, hit Miami-Dade and Broward counties. Miami-Dade County Mayor Daniela Levine-Cava even issued a very rare flash flood emergency. The images have been startling. Abandoned cars submerged in floodwaters as if they'd been driven into canals. Kids catching large fish in the streets. Climate experts ranked it a 1 in 1,000 years weather event. But it was just 1 year ago that they said the same thing about the biblical rains that flooded much of Broward County. What happened this week just raises the concern that we've got to brace for more than just hurricanes here. We've now got once every 1,000 year rains to contend with every year, overwhelming our drainage capacity, which is already compromised by sea level rise. All of which raises the question, how long can we keep ignoring that very wet climate change elephant in the room? Were you affected by this week's storm? Are we watching a new normal? Call us at 800-743-WLRN, 800-743-9576. Joining me now are two of the best climate and environment watchers in journalism, WLRN Environment Editor Jenny Stiletovich and Alex Harris, lead climate reporter for our news partner, the Miami Herald. Jenny, Alex, are you staying dry?
We're trying to.
Good. Now, Jenny, let's start by giving folks the meteorological background here. Where did this diluvial system come from? What made it so intense, and why did it hang around for so long?
Yeah, so it was a low-pressure system that moved out of the Gulf. It was really broad and really slow-moving. I talked to Rob Moeda at the National Weather Service in Miami this morning, and he said just that the size of it and the speed of it just brought us a lot of rain.
Right. Well, that was obvious. But even though we knew this was going to be a heavy, lingering system, do you think the actual weather event surprised meteorologists, especially that rare flash flood emergency? And is that still in effect today, or I think it's been downgraded,
it's
right?
It's been downgraded. Yeah. I mean, I don't think they were surprised. That's why we got the warnings, right?
Yeah, right.
But they did issue, the rare warning was it was a high risk for major flooding, and within their world, the high risk is unusual for us. And what that means is that within 6 hours in urban areas, you can have streets and parking lots turning into rivers. And
right, that's where the flash part comes in, right?
Right, yeah. And the high risk. You know, they have different categories, moderate risk, excessive risk, high risk is unusual.
Okay, so that was something unusual we saw this week. That makes sense. How about you, Alex? Were you surprised by what actually hit us, especially on Wednesday evening?
I think this was pretty well forecast. Starting Monday, we saw things from the Weather Prediction Center at NOAA, and local meteorologists were all warning us that Wednesday and Thursday were going to be pretty big rain days. But I think we were talking about totals of like 8, maybe 10 inches, not hitting 20 over 2 days. I think governments were prepared, meteorologists were prepared, residents, not so much.
Not so much. What struck you the most about how residents were not prepared? Especially since, you know, as we mentioned, we went through this last year. This is becoming the new norm. You'd think we'd know now how to respond. But when I was driving home Wednesday evening, I saw a lot of people who apparently didn't know how to respond.
Yeah, I think the driving the cars into the floodwaters was the thing that kind of shocked me. Obviously, everyone has to get home. You got to do what you got to do. But at this point in South Florida, you think the message of turn around, don't drown, and don't drive your car into a road where it's so deep you can't see the road, that's a message that, ironically, has not sunk in yet for most people down here.
Yeah. What also struck you most, Alex, about what you and the Herald photographers you were working with saw out there? I mean, in your report, Hollywood seemed especially hard hit, for example, especially homes like Sam DeMarco's, right?
Yeah, so our reporters were out all across the county, Broward and Miami-Dade, trying to find people and find cars and find stories of how we're responding to this horrific flood event. And we found Sam DeMarco, whose house had only just now dried out, it seems, from the April flood event in Fort Lauderdale that also hit his home in Hollywood. And by the time we saw him Wednesday evening, his home had a few inches of rain in it again. And the same story we heard from lots of people. It really wasn't that much water that made its way under the front door, but as every single car drove by, it sent a fresh wake and another wave of water into his home and soaked more and more.
Oh, that's really neighborly. Yeah. But I mean, when we see houses like Sam DeMarco's, what strikes you about the circumstances or the factors that make houses like his more vulnerable to that sort of thing?
The fact of the matter is most of South Florida was built low. It was built before we realized what our flood risk was going to be. We realized our flood risk was changing, and they're just not designed to handle these kinds of storms and this much water.
And I was also struck in your reports, there were a couple of people you interviewed who said, this is it. I'm leaving. I'm moving out of Florida.
Yeah, we did talk to a gentleman who said his house had flooded many, many times, and he said, you know what, I can't do it anymore. The expense, the health risks of having wet, moldy homes, and just the chaos of having to drain your home multiple times a year is more than most people want. And when you factor in the insurance costs that come with additional flood issues, it's just not it for most people.
Right, because, you know, before it was one thing to have this happen, quote, every once in a thousand years, but if it's happening every year, this I'm afraid we're going to see more of that. Jenny, it wasn't just the rain, of course. The other big factor was how vulnerable the already overwhelmed drainage infrastructure in Miami and South Florida is. What caused it to back up so badly this time?
Right. So you've got slow-moving rain that piles up so the groundwater level rises. Canals are already being kept higher to fight sea rise.
Yeah.
So if you've got a canal that's got a higher level to keep back sea rise, groundwater levels that are elevated, there's no place for the rain to go. So when you've got that much over that amount of time, slow moving, it has no place to go.
Right. But when we say it has no place to go, describe a little bit more for us that that natural phenomenon that perhaps, is unique to this region and its topography, et cetera.
Well, normally we would have wetlands that sort of absorb and act like sponges to soak up all the, we have a rain. I mean, that's how we are. We have a wet and dry season. That's South Florida. So we paved over a lot of those wetlands. We don't have to absorb the rainwater anymore. We also have a flood control system that was built back in the 40s. They have a series of coastal pumps. The Water Management District right now is evaluating those coastal pumps to replace them. Areas that flooded the worst are actually under construction. They're scheduled to be done in 2026, but
no,
that's still 2 years away.
Those are good technical reminders. And why do people out there keep opening manhole covers during storms like this, even when they've been told over and over again that it's dangerous and illegal?
I have no idea.
I think they're desperate for a fix. They want their streets dry.
Yeah, yeah. But the danger of it being, as I know, for example, Miami-Dade County reporter for the Herald, Doug Hanks, kept reminding people on Twitter is, you're doing a lot of damage when you do this. What is the damage that people do when they lift those manhole covers?
Well, you get rainwater into the sewage system. It's dangerous if it's underwater. It's a hazard. You can fall or drive
into
them.
But also the sewage system can then, at the same time, rise up into our,
Right, those aren't storm drains. Those are entries into the sewer system.
Now, Alex, what struck you most about how government officials here and in Broward County responded to the downpour? As I mentioned, Miami-Dade Mayor Levine Cava issued that rare flash flood emergency. What do you think rattled them most about what happened this week? Or, as you pointed out earlier, were they really not that rattled?
You know, I think experience is the best teacher. I talked to Broward Sheriff's Office, Michael B. Kane, Battalion Chief, earlier this week a couple of times, and he said that they were prepared. They had got their boats off the trailers, off the docks, ready to go so they could launch in neighborhoods and rescue people. They had high water vehicles. Miami-Dade also had plenty they were sending out to get people out of their cars, homes, and businesses. Again, I think the governments are understanding better how to respond. But I think what we've realized is there's just not enough temporary pumps or Vector trucks, which are those big trucks that soak up excess water enough to just take care of every single problem all the time. At some point, we're fighting against gravity in the bay.
Right. So we may need to budget for more of that sort of thing then. How lucky, though, Alex, were we that we didn't get that second round of biblical rain that had been forecast for last night? How bad would this have been if that had materialized?
Oh, boy, that would have not been great for places that were already soggy. We saw groundwater levels rise as much as 5 feet in one day in places in North Miami, in places like Hollandale Beach and Hollywood. And that means that there was so much less dry ground to soak up that extra floodwater. And like Jenny said, there's not that many green spaces to soak up that extra floodwater. So It wouldn't have taken more than just an inch or two of rain to set off another round of flash flooding.
Yeah, good point. Here's what Fort Lauderdale Mayor Dean Tantalus had to say about dodging that bullet.
That is certainly a function of the fact that there's a lot less water that came down in one small period of time. Remember last year it was 26 inches of rain in 5 hours, and here we're seeing about a foot of rain over a period of days. So we have seen water creep into people's homes. It's certainly not as severe as we did see last year.
That was, again, Fort Lauderdale Mayor Dean Trantalis. This is the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. I'm Tim Padgett. I'm talking with WLRN's Jenny Stiletovich and the Miami Herald's Alex Harris about this week's rain emergency and what it portends. Call us at 800-743-WLRN, 800-743-9576. And, in fact, we do have a caller, Brian from Oakland. I believe that's Oakland Park, is it? Calling. Brian, welcome to the South Florida Roundup. What did you experience this week?
We're Oakland Park.
Okay.
We're the flood capital of Broward County.
Okay.
And we all know that we are the flood capital, but it seems just that we only talk about it when there's a flood. And it happens every year, twice a year, that we get flooded, and nobody seems to do anything about it. And with all the technology today, you think we could come up with some kind of pump plan or something to be prepared? I heard the guest say, you know, are we prepared? How do you prepare for a flood at your house? I know don't drive the car on the freeway because it'll be flooded. But how do you prepare your house? Do you expect people to keep sandbags in the garage or, you know, how do you prepare for that?
Right.
We got water comes up. Go ahead.
No. I mean, those are great points, Brian, and it speaks to what we're going to be talking about right now, how residents like you in places like that have to start dealing with this on a year-by-year basis. So, Jenny, let's step back as we did last year and look at the bigger climate picture here. Should we be concerned to see two, quote, 1-in-1,000-year rainfalls smack us, not every 1,000 years, but 2 years in a row?
Right. So climate scientists have warned that as the planet heats up, there's more warmth in the atmosphere. You're going to get more moisture and you're going to have rainier events, whether they're hurricanes or systems like this. I will say to Brian's point.
I want to stop there right there.
Okay.
Because that was the first time anyone explained climate change to me as a journalist way back in the late 1990s. They stressed what you just pointed out, that global warming causes the clouds in the atmosphere to hold more precipitation for longer periods of time. Correct. And then when that water is finally released from the sky, we get what we got this week.
There's more moisture in the atmosphere, right?
Is that one of the big things people need to keep in mind when they're trying to associate climate change with the events that they're experiencing on the ground now?
The events are becoming more extreme. The climate is making the atmosphere more unstable. So that's, we get a rainstorm now is a torrential downpour. You know, it's an extreme event.
Okay. And so I'm sorry, I interrupted a point then that you
well,
were...
Well, no. So for Brian's point, I mean, the Water Management District is in the midst of planning to upgrade the pumps and stuff. Broward has its coastal pumps located farther inland than Miami-Dade County, and so that means more coastal places. Oakland Park is still kind of coastal.
Yeah.
Have to rely on a different kind. They have gravity. I mean, they can't pump the water like they do. Miami-Dade County has these coastal pumps on the little river closer to shore, so we've got more pumping capacity.
Right. Now, Alex, in one of your reports this week, you mentioned that this storm wasn't classified as a tropical system, as in a, quote, tropical storm, and yet these are levels of rain we usually associate with tropical systems. Now, I know in South Florida we're used to cognitive dissonance in our politics, but how do we reconcile this seeming contradiction in our subtropical weather patterns?
Yeah, like Jenny said, there's just more juice to squeeze out of the clouds when the atmosphere is warmer and holds more water. So you don't need to have a named tropical storm or a hurricane or a depression to get to the point where you can have water levels like this and rainfall like this. This is something that, you know, the climate change is raising the extremes. We're going to get drier, we're going to get wetter. And this is one of the times we're going to get wetter. When we think about it, we just have to be prepared for higher levels of rainfall than we've ever been prepared for.
And Jenny, let's put that drainage issue in the climate change context briefly as well. Is South Florida doing enough? You've been mentioning the pumping capacity, et cetera, but is it doing enough to mitigate the monstrous flooding effects of rains like these from above, given that sea level rise, another global warming crisis, is putting so much pressure on that infrastructure from below?
Right. So we're behind the eight ball, and now we're trying to catch up. I mean, there the level of service for flood control in Broward County is already maxed out. Jennifer Hirado with Broward County has talked repeatedly about the situation, the dire situation they're in. So it's catch up, right? There's a lot of plans underway now for the regional system and for local systems. Mm-hmm. But they're not coming online fast enough.
Alex, in the 15 seconds we have left, you agree?
Totally agree. Brian, look up flood barriers online. They can help you keep your house dry.
Oh, I hope you got that, Brian. Alex Harris is the Miami Herald's lead climate reporter. Jenny Stiletovich is WLRN's environment editor. Many thanks to you both.
Thanks, Tim.
Thanks, Tim.
I am hardly the only parent here who has a story like this. 25 years ago, just after our family had moved to Miami, I was installing something on the patio with my back to our swimming pool. I thought my 2-year-old daughter was playing on the swing set, but she'd managed to get around the pool fencing and had quietly gotten into the pool, where, when I finally turned around, I saw her starting to drown. I got to her in time. I'm one of the lucky parents. Too many others here have had young children die in swimming pools, including 8-year-old Ryan Amichette, who drowned this month in a neighbor's pool in Fort Lauderdale. Our hearts go out to his family, and our praises go out to those who are working to increase access to swimming instruction for children in South Florida, where swimming pools are so plentiful. That's especially important now in the summer when kids are out of school, and especially for minority kids like Ryan, who was black, who have a higher drowning death rate than white kids. Have you been touched by this danger to children? Do you want to get your kids swimming lessons this summer? Call us at 800-743-WLRN, 800-743-9576. Joining me now are two people who are, in fact, responsible for helping more South Florida children learn to swim. Dr. Bridget McKinney is the principal at Miami Carroll City Senior High School, and she's also president and founder of PSWAP, or Professionals Sharing with a Purpose, based in Opa-locka, which offers free swimming lessons for kids in Miami-Dade County. Anna Stewart is the manager of the Drowning Prevention Coalition of Palm Beach County. Thank you both for being with us.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Dr. McKinney, let me start with you and one of the most sobering statistics about this problem. According to the Federal Center for Disease Control and Prevention, or CDC, and the American Red Cross, drowning is the leading cause of death in this country for children ages 1 to 4 years old. Why do you think that's the case?
This is the unsounding board that has been resounding for years. And I sit on the American Red Cross Scientific Advisory Council for the American Red Cross. Mm-hmm. And I tell you, a lot of research have gone behind the why. And what we have discovered as a pattern is that the access to water, supervision, at some point, no parent can imagine or have ever planned to lose a child by water. And so what we have found is that kids love water.
Yeah.
And so their attempts to get to the bodies of water at any point, not just pools, ponds, lakes, any waterfronts, we have to be very vigilant. And unfortunately, the picture is the same. The frame may change, but the picture hasn't changed any as it relates to those kids 1 to 4.
Is this problem as bad here specifically in South Florida, particularly for Black and Latino children?
We found that the black, brown, and tan children are in the higher range. Surprisingly, what we have discovered is that kids of color, yes, drown at a higher rate, but it's almost equal to those individuals that are white,
mm-hmm.
because they have access, they have pools in the backyards.
Right, so is the problem in South Florida equal, higher than, say, the rest of the country, precisely because, as I pointed out before, we have so many more pools here?
Florida does lead.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Florida does lead.
So tell us, what inspired Peace Swap and how it and groups like yours are spreading the gospel of free swimming instruction for children, especially minority children, in our communities here? How do these programs and their instruction work?
Oh, I'm so glad you asked that, because I heard your heartfelt story you shared. But in 2016, there were two incidents related to children's age 1 to 4. One of those individuals did not make it. The other one did survive.
Mm-hmm.
When I saw the story air on Channel 7, 10, and 4, I was sitting in my bedroom watching, and I was thinking, wow, when I looked around the area, all the pools were closed.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. So there was no access to learning to swim. I happened to be at a facility for an event at Opa-locka, and I said to them, if they allow me to come in, I will provide these instructions at no cost.
Right. So you base your free swimming instruction in Opa-locka then?
Based on where those incidents occurred.
Okay.
Uh-huh. And so...
What is the swimming facility in Opa-locka that you use?
So it's a large facility. It goes up to 5 feet. It had been underutilized. And I brought that programming just to provide the access mm-hmm. to lessons, because lessons sometimes they're not affordable.
Sure.
And so I said, if I make it free, maybe this will get our parents mm-hmm. Of color to come.
And your instructors are volunteers?
My instructors are professionals like I am. You mentioned I was a principal.
Right.
I have hired lifeguards that are also firefighters, police officers, and nurses.
Wow. How many do you have on your staff?
Well, I had to increase now. I mean, I started off with a base thinking I would only address about 100 kids the first year, and that was 10 years ago. We have now since grown to 400 every summer.
Okay.
So my instructors, I'm an instructor trainer, so I'm able to train my staff and mm-hmm. I certify them so that they can provide those instructions.
Anna Stewart, in April, Florida Governor Ron DeSantis signed SB 544 into law, which creates the state's first swimming lesson voucher program for kids 1 to 4 years old, that age group, again, for whom drowning is the chief cause of death in the U.S. Why do you think the state legislature considered this such an important issue, not just in South Florida, but for all of Florida?
Well, we're surrounded by water. No matter where you go, there is water. And it is a fact that children ages 1 through 4 do have the highest drowning rate nationwide. And I think Ron DeSantis wanted to be proactive regarding this issue. So hence implementing mm-hmm. this type of programming through right. the health departments.
And how will this legislation help groups like yours, the Drowning Prevention Coalition of Palm Beach County, move forward in your efforts? Tell us more about what exactly your group up there does.
So our organization, we basically go into the elementary schools, middle schools, high schools, anybody who's willing to listen to us talk. We go and we do free land-based water safety programming. In addition to that, we also have a free reduced cost swim program for children ages 2 through 12 and their immediate caregiver. I think it's very important to mention that a lot of adults themselves don't know how to swim. So it's uh-huh. just as important
right.
for adults to learn in addition to children. Oftentimes we think children drowning,
mm-hmm.
but in Palm Beach County, we have seniors that are drowning because they are by themselves in a body of water. So I think it's an important reminder that a drowning can happen to anyone, regardless of their age, race, gender, and socioeconomic
right.
background.
Uh-huh.
Our organization, we have 18 aquatic facilities in Palm Beach County that participate in our free reduced cost swim program that is funded by the Palm Beach County Children's Services Council,
right.
as well as one of those programs
schools in pools.
Yes, we do have a schools and pools program, which post COVID honestly was not up and running. But for the first time, we had the Glades area, which is a quite underserved population. We did have a Schools and Pools where a Gove Elementary went to one of the local aquatic facilities and was transported because a child with autism who attended that school unfortunately passed away due to a drowning.
Right.
So we're hoping moving forward that we're going to implement more Schools and Pools where children go during the school day.
Okay.
To receive swim lessons.
Okay. Dr. McKinney, I know Miami Gardens, a predominantly black city here in Miami-Dade County, now offers free swimming lessons for kids, and Mayor Rodney Harris is a big backer of that program. How did Miami Gardens, for example, get that done, and how can other municipalities here imitate what they're doing?
So the American Red Cross provides a program called the Centennial Campaign,
uh-huh.
and this allows programs to sign up their organizations or counties or municipalities, and they can receive those scholarships that the American Red Cross provides, a supplemental amount so that you can offer these programming at no cost.
Have we seen other municipalities like Miami Gardens in Miami-Dade County, in Broward or in Palm Beach, for example, put together the same kind of program that Miami Gardens has?
Not only have we seen it doing in the parks and recreation, we also see it in Miami-Dade County Public Schools, which we have the pools in the schools as well.
Okay.
Well, I've now seen the expansion because they are eliciting, they look at the map and they look at those high rates and those zip codes and they target those areas to provide those services. And yes, it's easy. You can just apply through the American Red Cross Centennial Campaign.
Just quickly, tell us a little bit more about Schools and Pools. How does that work and how can families access it?
So when your school or the principal, which I did when I was a principal at Scott Lake Elementary School, you can sign up through Miami-Dade County Public Schools office and they would allow you a period of time, which is a 9 weeks. We call it 9 weeks. And they will bring the pool to you with the instructor.
Wow.
That's right. Okay. Inside, and they'll do what we call, they would do the infrastructure changes if it's needed, and they would flip a classroom, basically. I converted my media center into a pool for the last 9 weeks because this was leading right into the Water Safety Month, and I was like, and it's getting hot. As it gets hotter, you start seeing more interest.
But it costs some money to convert a space like that into a pool. How exactly is that funded?
That is funded through our Title III funding.
Okay. That's fantastic to know. This is the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. I'm Tim Padgett. I'm speaking with Dr. Bridget McKinney of PSWAP and Anna Stewart of the Drowning Prevention Coalition of Palm Beach County about how we can reduce the tragic number of child drowning victims here. Call us at 800-743-WLRN, 800-743-9576. Dr. McKinney, I just want to step back for just a moment and consider the culture, the mindset, let's say, of swimming in minority communities and how you're working to change it or make it more aware and engaged. I'm thinking, for example, of that lovely, iconic moment in the Oscar-winning movie Moonlight, set in Miami, where the father figure Juan takes young Chiron out into the ocean to learn to swim. It almost seems to break down a wall that somehow exists between black children and swimming. How important has it been for you to get people to see that wall and show them how to break it down?
So great point. And I want to piggyback on what she said. It's that barrier should go beyond the color, right, of our skin. But what we have found that there are some barriers and they are restrictive. People who have had no exposure to water, and she mentioned adults,
right?
So that carries on. That tone is translated on in those households, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. And so if I don't learn to swim as an adult, I probably would not encourage a child to learn to swim as well. And so breaking down those barriers is continuing messaging like we're doing right now. The Children Trust has provided a lot of what we call airway time or promotion time that they have provided these services out in the public so that they can learn about these free programming and they begin to come. Mm-hmm. And so it's a work in progress, but right now we have serviced in 10 years over 4,000 kids. So it's possible. And they are all been children of color or families of color.
Anna Stewart, let me ask you that same question. One would think that in a water activity culture like South Florida, swimming would be natural for all kids, and yet Black and Latino children seem to confront barriers to it. How do we go about changing that, you know, whether it's here or in Palm Beach County?
I think it's important for us to have a curriculum within the school system itself, talking about the importance of water safety and drowning prevention. I like to say I'm not here to scare you. I'm here to prepare you. It's a life-saving skill. Learning to swim is a life-saving skill, and I cannot say that enough, because parents put their children in all different types of sports. They spend a lot of money, but yet we know that learning to swim can save one's life. So I really think if we get the children excited about learning to swim, hopefully that will radiate to the caregivers at home.
Right. Now, I also want to touch again on this idea that schools can play such an important role in this. For example, my producer, Helen Acevedo, is just reminding me right now that in the Miami-Dade County Public Schools, there's a program called Learn to Swim, or if my 62-year-old eyesight were better, LTSP, also known as iSwim. Is that correct, Dr. McKinney?
That is correct.
Okay.
And so, and I'm getting some information as well. It's actually Title IV that funds it. And yes, they do have a built-in program. And I'm going to go back. Equally important, learning to swim and water safety skills, knowing what to do when you are faced in a situation,
yes.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Being able to respond.
Right.
Most individuals think the first thing to do is to jump in. But the truth of the matter is, reach your throat, don't go. You can keep yourself and others safe. And so she's mentioning about that dry land. We put a strong emphasis during those off season on that dry land. In fact, before they get in the water, we use a whole segment on what you can do to prevent yourselves to get into a situation or danger. Mm-hmm. We also incorporate CPR training for all of our parents.
Mm-hmm. Now, my producer, Helen Acevedo, also mentions that this iSwim program is into its 50th year.
Yes.
Wow. I mean, that's great to know that's so established. Yeah.
Why is it like this hidden secret?
Yeah.
Miami-Dade County has been doing this for that long. So I'm encouraging all principals, if you have a chance, blow them up and say you want that program at your school. Now, it's only offered for eight for those grade levels, pre-K through third grade.
Okay. But still, it's like you said, it's been there, it's established, and we should be taking advantage of it. Anna Stewart, I also wanted to ask you and Dr. McKinney, if a parent or someone like that adult character, Juan, in the movie Moonlight, who knows how to swim, wants to take it upon themselves to teach a child to swim, what should they do first in terms of learning the basics about how to teach kids to swim? For example, should you teach a child how to tread water before they learn how to dog paddle, that sort of thing?
I'm going to be honest with you. We don't recommend parents teaching their children to learn how to swim. We recommend them going to a certified water safety instructor. If parents are really interested, believe it or not, Palm Beach County is offering free lifeguard and free water safety instructor courses for individuals that are 15 and over, because there's been such a shortage of lifeguards and water safety instructors nationwide. So to combat that, the Children's Services Council of Palm Beach County and the Palm Beach County Parks and Recreation Department has actually decided to partner to provide these classes.
Okay.
So honestly, I recommend parents not teaching their children, really have a professional go ahead and do that.
Well, unfortunately, we are out of time. I wish we could spend more time talking about this because it's so important. But Dr. Bridget McKinney heads PSWAP in Miami-Dade County. Anna Stewart manages the Drowning Prevention Coalition of Palm Beach County. Thanks very much to you both. I really appreciate
it. Thank you. Thank you for getting this messaging out.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you kindly. Appreciate it.
I started my career in Chicago, once known as the University of Underhanded Election Strategies. But I got to admit, Miami is schooling the Windy City these days, especially with popular scams like the quote, ghost candidate. That's a candidate you put on the ballot for the sole purpose of siphoning votes away from the candidate you want to defeat. That's how political experts say Democratic incumbent Jose Javier Rodriguez lost his state Senate seat to Republican Ileana Garcia 4 years ago, thanks to ghost candidate Alex Rodriguez, whose last name punked just enough voters into casting ballots for him instead of the other Rodriguez. Former GOP State Senator Frank Artiles of Miami is currently on trial for orchestrating that scheme. This week, Miami New Times alerted us to Maureen Saunders Scott, a Jacksonville resident who is suddenly an independent candidate for the Florida House District 106 election, where the Democratic candidate is former state representative Joe Saunders. Gosh, what do you think? Is it just a crazy coincidence that Maureen has the same last name as Joe? Call us at 800-743-WLRN, 800-743-9576. Joining me now to discuss the ghost candidate ruse and other political controversies as we approach Florida's August primary election are Miami New Times staff writer Naomi Feinstein, who along with her colleague Alex DeLuca discovered mysterious Maureen's name on the House District 106 ballot, and WLRN government accountability reporter Joshua Ceballos. Naomi, Josh, thanks for being here.
Pleasure to be here.
Thank you for having me.
So, Naomi, great reporting this week. How did you hear about Maureen Saunders Scott appearing on the ballot for this state House seat? Who is she?
Yeah, so what caught our attention was some Miami Beach residents who saw that she had filed to run and immediately were drawn to Saunders and seeing there being two Saunders.
And again, remind us who the other Saunders is.
Joe Saunders.
Right, the Democratic candidate.
Yes. Yeah, okay. And to be honest, we don't know much. Mm-hmm. We have gotten public records that reveal that she is Joe Saunders' aunt. She lives,
just gets more.
Okay. To be quite honest, we don't know why she is running. We don't know the motive. I have tried to speak with her. I have not heard back yet. If I do hear back, I will surely be letting everyone know.
Now, if she is a ghost candidate put there to help defeat him, there must be some family spat here.
There have been some rumors and some questions of a family spat. I don't know much beyond that yet. But she lives all the way near Jacksonville, nowhere near Miami Beach.
Hundreds of miles away.
Miami Beach. Yeah. And so a lot of questions still remain.
Okay. And she is, quote unquote, running against not just Joe Saunders, but who are the other? Who is the other candidate in that election?
The incumbent is Fabian Basabi, if some of you are not familiar.
Yes, another controversial figure.
Exactly.
Yes.
Uh-huh. So on its face before, this race was controversial. And now the stakes have gotten even more controversial and messier.
And tell us why Fabian is so controversial.
So Fabian is I've been covering him actually a lot in this district. He's been getting a lot of upset residents who felt that he flip-flopped from his campaign promises, supporting a lot of the DeSantis sort of anti-LGBTQ legislation that residents felt. Mm-hmm. He has also been accused. He's been involved in a lot of different investigations, though which the investigations have ruled them to be inconclusive in terms of him allegedly slapping an aide. He has denied the allegation.
Right.
Just very tabloid-worthy headlines.
And tell us really quickly about Joe Saunders himself, the Democratic candidate. Who is he? Where does he come from?
Yeah, so he was one of the first openly gay members of the Florida legislature. He was representing up in Orlando. Mm-hmm. He's been involved in Equality Florida, the advocacy group involved in LGBTQ rights down here and in Florida. And he's been filed to run since last May over what's been going on in the district.
Right. Okay. Josh Ceballos.
Yes.
Mo Saunders. Is that also how she's known? Is that what we're calling her now?
That's what the big break has been.
Because we want to get to know her better, right?
Yeah. She's changed to Mo for Maureen.
Okay, so Josh, Mo Saunders is hardly the first ghost candidate to spook us here in Miami and around Florida. In fact, just last week, political consultant Eric Fogelsong pleaded no contest to involvement in a ghost candidate scheme up in Seminole County. But as I mentioned, perhaps the more key case of ghost candidate engineering involves former Republican State Senator Frank Artiles, who allegedly put his buddy Alex Rodriguez on the ballot here in 2020 to help defeat incumbent Democratic State Senator Jose Javier Rodriguez. Artiles is currently on trial for that scheme. Josh, what exactly is Artiles charged with, and where does this trial stand at this point?
We could really do a master class on ghost candidates here in Florida, to be honest. So yeah, so Frank Artiles was charged with a couple of different election-related charges, including conspiracy to make or accept campaign contributions in excess of legal limits, False swearing in connection to an election, and submitting false voter information.
Okay, so that's important to remind people that that's all the kind of stuff that can be entailed in a ghost candidate
right.
scheme. So this isn't just some sort of fun political shenanigans. This can actually get you in really legal hot water.
This is a crime. This
yeah.
is a crime. So that trial has been delayed a lot. It was supposed to go to... The case has been delayed. It was supposed to go to trial this February, but it's been pushed mm-hmm. back until later this year, I think around October
okay.
or September actually is the trial date. There have been a lot of depositions, a lot of interviews, a lot of back and forth within the court docket. But as of right now, there hasn't been an official first day of trial.
Now, we should also mention that Frank Artelis has gotten into hot water for other controversies besides this ghost candidate scheme.
Right. And so, yeah, he was kind of... unceremoniously ousted from the state legislature after mm-hmm. using the N-word and using racial slurs. Also, I should mention that while Artelis has pled not guilty,
mm-hmm.
Alex Rodriguez, his acquaintance and who was involved in the ghost candidate,
had to pay a big fine, right?
He pleaded guilty right. and he agreed to testify against Artelis.
Okay. All right. So not just the person who engineers the scam, but the ghost candidate themselves.
Right.
Can get into legal
very,
hot water.
Very spooky.
Yeah. So given all that, Naomi, what struck you the most about Maureen Saunders Scott's ghost candidacy, if we can call it that? How was it so easy for, as we said before, a Jacksonville resident like her to make it onto a state House seat ballot for a district covering Miami Beach, among other areas?
Yeah, I mean, as soon as I saw the residents talking about it, it just struck me because it did not sit right with me that, like, no one was seeing this, and because immediately I saw Saunders and Saunders, and I don't want to jump to some nefarious conclusion, mm-hmm. but she was able to do it. There she has to file the specific forms, which there are public disclosure forms, your statement for why you're running. I mean, not why you're running, but more so just.
But what about the residency requirement?
So as far as I can see, I have to do some more digging and find mm-hmm. out from the Election Commission, but as far as I know, as long as she is living in the district when she assumes office, she's good.
Uh-huh. So let's say she's in Jacksonville on August 20th. She wins. As long as she comes down to live in Miami Beach, it's kosher.
That's what I'm seeing in the handbook. Again, I have to do some more checking, but as far as I can see in the handbook, it says assumes office.
So as long as she can afford an apartment in Miami Beach.
Yes,
okay.
Exactly.
Okay.
And she's fully qualified according to their website. So that's what I'm seeing.
Okay. So, but again, as we talk about what it takes to get on the ballot to run for a state House seat in Florida, otherwise she seems to have followed the procedure.
Yes.
Okay. So you have still not been able to get Maureen Saunders Scott to respond to your questions, right?
We nope. just. I have called her since Monday we reported it. I have left her voicemails. Her voicemail box is now full.
Uh-huh.
I've sent her an emails. Me and my coworker, colleague Alex have, and we haven't heard anything yet. And we're eager to hear from her.
Okay. And so as a result, we still have really no idea who might be behind getting her on the District 106 ballot. Because as we've seen in other schemes like this, there's always someone engineer, you know, there's always some Wizard of Oz behind the curtain, right?
Yeah.
Like Frank Artelis. Yeah. Okay. So, but we just don't know
we
then.
We simply do not know.
Okay. So, Josh, what strikes you most about how seemingly easy it is for supposed ghost candidates like Alex Rodriguez or Maureen Saunders Scott to get on ballots that easily, that way?
I mean, it's just kind of like an only in Florida, only in Miami
yeah.
type situation that's just so shocking. I mean, when I was reading Naomi's reporting, I thought, okay, but we caught it this time. We saw this happen in the last election. We can keep this from happening. But then she qualified, and
yeah.
she's going to be on the ballot. And as Mo Saunders, right next to Joe Saunders, that's crazy.
So but, no matter how much we spray for this, it just keeps coming back.
It just keeps coming back.
Yeah. So this is the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. I'm Tim Padgett. I'm speaking with Naomi Feinstein of Miami New Times and WLRN's Joshua Ceballos about ghost candidates and other election controversies here. Call us at 800-743-WLRN, 800-743-9576. Naomi, why do you think the ghost candidate fad has become so popular in Miami and Florida, and more important, stepping back a few seconds, looking at the forest from the trees, what does it say about the state of our general political culture down here?
I think Josh kind of said it best, like a lot of dirty politics down here, unfortunately. And I think people are just kind of getting more creative, I guess. And
yeah, because I said, like, when I started my journalism career in Chicago, I mean, I saw a lot of appalling stuff. But I got to admit, they've really refined it, you know, here with this kind of phenomenon.
Yeah, and I think lobbyists and these power brokers here have, yeah, they want to try and stay back from the public and not in public, not to realize what they're, because PAC money, that's been a lot of discussion now, word money and dark money. But I think these more elaborate creative schemes, I think, are a way to be like, to really kind of fool people, unfortunately.
Right. The deceptiveness of it perhaps has become more sophisticated.
Yeah, it's mm-hmm. kind of concerning, and I don't blame voters to want to call this out.
Mm-hmm. And I should mention, too, this is not just a Republican problem. And when I started my career in Chicago, it was the Democrats doing this kind of thing, not the machine, as we called it, not the Republicans.
Yeah, it's just across the political sphere.
Yeah. I mean, so, Josh, you know, speaking of Miami's political culture then, ghost candidates aren't the only controversy as we approach Florida's primary election on August 20th, right? We've mm-hmm. also got another suspended Miami-Dade commissioner, Joe Martinez, who was arrested back in 2022 for alleged unlawful compensation and unlawful compensation conspiracy. He's actually running now for the new post of Miami-Dade County Sheriff. Again, only in Miami, right? Why is he doing this, and why does he stand any chance of winning?
It's like people like to say, because Miami. Why is he doing this? I mean, so Joe Martinez has held that he is not guilty of this, that his arrest, the charges, are all politically motivated by people who don't want him to run for sheriff. What he was arrested for, we should say, is allegedly voting in favor of someone, a constituent in West Kendall, and trying to change the laws so that this constituent could do something with their business. And he mm-hmm. was allegedly paid $15,000 or $1,500 to do this for this constituent. But does he stand a chance of winning? It's hard to say because it's kind of a packed race. I mean, the sheriff's race has a ton of candidates.
Uh-huh.
So many. And there's a lot of front runners. I don't really know where Joe Martinez stands.
Right. And let me just ask you also real quickly, another former Miami-Dade commissioner, Alex Diaz de la Portilla, who is now facing trial on serious corruption and bribery charges, he's now being investigated for witness tampering. Where does that stand now?
As of the witness tampering, the court said that they're investigating it, and there's still nothing in the docket that kind of reflects that. But his case is still, they're still doing discovery. It hasn't gone to trial either. And I should correct myself earlier. So Joe Martinez is accused of accepting $15,000.
Okay.
So as far as Alex Diaz de la Portilla, yeah, he's still awaiting trial as well.
Well, finally, Naomi, just real quickly, let me ask you just one sort of other overarching question. The fact that we've got a presidential candidate in Donald Trump running now after he's become a convicted felon, what kind of ripple effect do you think that will have on what people feel like, you know, they're emboldened to get away with in Miami?
Yeah, no, it's a good question. I think it's kind of concerning, and people are very dismissive of that. And I think it kind of will be interesting to see how willing people will go, how desperate they'll get to do that.
Naomi Feinstein is a staff writer for the Miami New Times. Joshua Ceballos is WLRN's government accountability reporter. Many thanks to you both. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Tim.
Thanks, Tim.
Finally, on the roundup, kids, of course, love getting out of school for the summer. But for too many kids, that also means they won't receive their regular school meals. According to the nonprofit No Kid Hungry, in the summer, two-thirds of all low-income families say they have to choose between food and other necessities like utilities and medical care. So we want to remind those families here about Florida's federally funded Summer Break Spot program. Kids and teens across the state will receive free breakfast and lunch at their local churches, schools, libraries, and other venues between now and the start of the school year later in August. Anyone 18 or younger is eligible for those meals. To find your local Summer Break Spot site and for more information in English, Spanish, or Creole, visit summerbreakspot.org. dial 211 or text food or comida to 304-304. That will do it for the South Florida Roundup. It's produced by Helen Acevedo. And Helen, thank you so much for everything. And Jimena Romero with help from Polly Landis. Katie Munoz is our director of original live programming. Mateo Sanchez is digital editor. Sergio Bustos is WLRN's vice president of news. The vice president of radio and the show's technical supervisor is Peter J. Mertz. Richard Ives answers the phones. I'm Tim Padgett. Have a great weekend, and thanks for listening. Gracias, merci, obrigado.
WLRN.